Hey everybody, Dr. Hagmeyer here. And when it comes to thyroid disease, one of the questions that's commonly comes up is about goitrogens, okay? Many times when reviewing a patient's 7-day food journal, I notice that there's so many good healthy foods that are lacking, right? Foods like broccoli and cabbage and kale, right? Cauliflower, for example. And I'm told that often the reason for why the patient isn't consuming these foods is that they've been told or they read somewhere, or they've listened to some doctor's podcast that cruciferous vegetables, again, like the ones you see listed here, are harmful to the thyroid gland because they cause goiters. Now, this is a huge problem because a lot of you out there are living in fear of eating these highly dense, nutritious foods like the ones you saw just a moment ago. These foods should be enjoyed. They should be eaten often and regularly, and especially if you are a woman. So in today's video, I want to dispel this myth about these foods and goiters, but most importantly, I want you to know the real reasons behind why goiters develop in the first place. And if you or a loved one have these goiters, what you want to do to address the root cause of this goiter. So first off, a few words about a goiter. First and foremost, I want you to know that a goiter is a symptom, okay? It's a side effect that you potentially have a much more serious problem on your hand. And you're going to understand why I'm saying that here in just a moment. When you hear about someone saying that they have a goiter, you might be visualizing someone with this big, huge, large, lump in their throat that kind of looks like this, okay? But perhaps your doctor told you that the real reason you have a goiter is because you have an iodine deficiency. And this, my friends, is one of the biggest misunderstandings when it comes to goiters. It's almost as big as a misunderstanding that a person with a normal TSH and a normal T4, having all the thyroid symptoms, that there's really nothing wrong with their thyroid, okay? Here's the real deal. A goiter is an enlargement of the thyroid gland tissue, and it's most commonly caused by this excessive, chronic, ongoing stimulation of the thyroid gland, as in the case of a person who has hyperthyroidism, or in the case of an undiagnosed autoimmune disease known as Hashimoto's disease. Either way, if you have a goiter, you can almost bank on the fact that you have an autoimmune disease. Okay, both hyperthyroidism and hypothyroidism are autoimmune diseases. And in the United States, the number one cause of hypothyroidism is, you guessed it, Hashimoto's disease. So when a person has Hashimoto's disease, it's important to recognize that they may have symptoms of both hyperthyroidism and symptoms of hypothyroidism. You can almost bank when a person has these symptoms of both that they do have Hashimoto's, especially in some cases when they have a normal TSH and a normal T4. And I want to show you this. Here is a person I began working with, and as you can see, the TSH is what? You can see here it's normal, right? It's within the normal range. And now if you look at the T4 levels, you'll also notice what? That they are also normal. But now I want you to look at what it says here in this section under antibodies. All right, can you see this? It says what? Are they normal? Absolutely not. Their lab values show 714. Now, I don't care what the number is. Any number out of range is a serious problem. Really, for that matter, any detection of antibodies against the thyroid gland is a problem, okay? Just perhaps in an earlier stage. So as you might have guessed, this person's doctor told them everything was normal because the only testing that was run was a TSH and a T4. And this, again, is why it's so important to have a full and complete thyroid panel. Cases like this are missed every single day. So here's what's going on when you have a goiter in simple layman's terms. Okay, if you look at this picture, here's your pituitary gland. And when your pituitary gland, the purpose of the pituitary gland is to produce something called TSH. And of course, TSH stands for thyroid stimulating hormone. And that TSH is like a microphone, right? It's going to stimulate, or it's going to yell at the thyroid gland to make thyroid hormones, right? And then again, of course, the thyroid gland is going to make T3 and it's going to make T4. And now, in response to that TSH signal from the brain, your thyroid will do one of two things, okay? It's either going to make an appropriate hormones like we want it to, or it's going to ignore the signal. Well, if it ignores the signal, what the pituitary gland is going to do is it's going to just yell a little bit louder, all right? In other words, it's going to make more TSH, and the TSH numbers are going to go up, up, up. Now, if the pituitary gland needs to continue yelling at the thyroid gland, at some point, this continuous stimulation of the thyroid gland is going to cause the thyroid gland to enlarge. And that's an important concept to understand, because that's the real reason why a goiter develops. Okay. Now, while it is true that the thyroid gland can enlarge for other reasons, it could be an iodine deficiency, it could be pregnancy, it could be thyroid cancer, it could be an infection. But all of these reasons, if we took them all together and we added them all up, they still don't add up to the primary reason in terms of why a goiter develops in the first place. And that, again, is rooted in an autoimmune disease, again, being either hyper or hypothyroidism. So again, chronic, undiagnosed stimulation of the thyroid gland, Hashimoto's or hypothyroidism, is the real reason behind you have this goiter. Now, three things I want you to remember about today's video. Number one is that over 90% of women who are diagnosed with thyroid disease have an underlying autoimmune disease called Hashimoto's. Okay, very important to understand. Number two is, if you have Hashimoto's and you have a normal TSH and you have a normal T4 levels, like I showed you the test results of that one patient, because again, I have hundreds of patients like this that I've seen, and I guarantee you that the more doctors that begin testing and running these complete thyroid panels, they too soon will start seeing what I've been seeing for years and years. Number three, if you have Hashimoto's disease, your problem again is not your thyroid. Okay, I want you to think about, when you have these antibodies against your thyroid, I want you to think about this as not a thyroid problem anymore. I want you to start thinking about this as an autoimmune disease. And now the shift and the focus and the attention needs to be less on the thyroid and trying to make your thyroid numbers look pretty on paper, but now focusing on all the triggers behind an autoimmune disease. Okay? With those three facts, the odds are that are this, is if you have a goiter, you either have Hashimoto's disease or you have hyperthyroidism, which is Graves' disease. And chances are, if you have hyperthyroidism, that's not usually misdiagnosed. That's usually, you know, something that's pretty easy for your doctor to spot. So now that we've talked about the most common causes of goiters and that they are most often not being caused, rather, by eating cruciferous vegetables, you're going to want to start including these cruciferous vegetables like broccoli and cabbage and cauliflower and kale back into your diet. And the reason being is that these foods are loaded with hormone balancing, anti-cancer, antioxidant properties. And again, some of these root vegetables like sweet potatoes and turnips and rutabaga provide rich sources of complex carbs that you really do need. Now, these cruciferous vegetables, as well as sweet potatoes and strawberries and things like that, also contain carotenoids, which are, again, these carotenoids are precursors to vitamin A, which are very important for gut health, which again, when we look at the role and the connection between thyroid health and gut health, we know that a big part of that T4 to T3 conversion takes place in the gut and also takes place in the liver. So again, by avoiding these foods, you may be setting yourself up for not only a nutritional deficiency, but a natural means of maintaining healthy hormone and estrogen levels. And that brings us to the next concept when it relates to healthy hormones, and that's a very common problem that we see in women and men, which is estrogen dominance. Now, estrogen dominance is a term that describes a condition where a woman could have a deficiency of estrogen, she could have excessive estrogen, or she could have very little to no progesterone. Okay, so it could be a combination of any of those, right? You could be deficient, you could have normal levels of estrogen but low levels of progesterone, or again, you could have excessive estrogen with little to no progesterone levels as well. So again, all of these things can lead ultimately to a state of estrogen dominance. And again, every woman with low estrogen levels can have estrogen dominance symptoms, okay? So she doesn't have to just have high estrogen. So again, that sometimes gets misinterpreted and confused in many circles. So again, this imbalance, this estrogen-progesterone imbalance, can create problems such as decreased sex drive. It can cause irregular menstrual cycles. It can cause bloating and water retention. It can cause breast tenderness and swelling, painful breasts right around the menstrual cycle. It can cause headaches. It can cause mood swings and irritability. It can cause brain fog. And again, this is just a huge problem for women during perimenopause, during menopause, or women that are on birth control pills. So these are three times of a woman's life where we see this estrogen dominant state being most profound. So again, many of these cruciferous vegetables, the very ones that you perhaps may have been avoiding, these cruciferous vegetables help break down and they help metabolize this estrogen. And what that means is if you are not eating them, your ability to break down this estrogen and stifle this estrogen dominance is going to be compromised. So another thing that's worth mentioning here is that we now know that estrogen in many ways also interferes with thyroid hormones. So if you're not eating these foods and you're becoming increasingly estrogen dominant, then you're also going to become or influence and affect your thyroid in a negative way, because we know that too much estrogen, again, estrogen dominance, can also lead to thyroid hormone imbalances. Now, if you look here, here's a great study from 2011 showing the powerful benefits of a compound found in broccoli called 3,3-diindolemethane. And again, this is a sulfur-based compound. And if we look at the conclusion of the study, what does it show us? It shows that this compound, 3,3-diindolemethane, has an anti-estrogenic activity on the body. So it reduces thyroid proliferative diseases. We see this in many times in cases of thyroid cancer, and we certainly see this in cases where there are goiters. So this stuff to me is just incredible because it shows us that food is medicine. And so the point of all this is to show you that you should not be afraid of eating these cruciferous vegetables. You should be eating these cruciferous vegetables regularly on a daily basis, if not several times a week. Now, the last topic for today's video is what do you do if you have a goiter, right? So number one is if you can feel a lump or a bump in your thyroid, the first thing I want you to do is bring this to the attention of your primary care doctor. And again, most of the time, if a patient has a goiter and they haven't already had an ultrasound, this is a good time to get one. If you notice that lump or that bump or even pain, you know, in your neck, okay? Very important time to have that ultrasound done. Second thing that you want to be aware of is that you need to consider the underlying cause or the mechanism behind why you have the goiter, right? Do you have elevated levels of TSH? Or do you have elevated levels of human growth hormone? Do you have Hashimoto's disease? Do you have Graves' disease? Do you have thyroid antibodies that are showing up and that have been picked up on testing, okay? If you haven't been tested for these things, I want you to watch the video that I did that talks about thyroid antibodies, because I go into some of these things. But it's very important to have these tests done if you've never had these tests done up to this point in time. In that video, I go through the different kinds of antibodies that you want to look for, and again, the significance of them and what they do and what these antibodies mean when they're out of range. So to wrap this video up, I have five important reminders because I know we've talked about a lot of things today. So again, number one is that a goiter is a symptom. Number two is we talked about cruciferous vegetables not being the cause of a goiter. Number three, we talked about how these cruciferous vegetables are of tremendous benefit to both men and women, not only with hormonal imbalances in terms of how they relate to estrogen dominance and andropause, but the role that these cruciferous vegetables play in helping maintain healthy estrogen levels, okay? Very, very important. And again, the relationship between the estrogen levels or the high estrogen levels and the suppression of the thyroid gland. Number four, the most common cause of goiter in the United States is not a deficiency or overconsumption of these goitrogenic foods, but rather an underdiagnosed or a missed autoimmune disease, either being Hashimoto's disease or Graves' disease, hyperthyroidism. And number five, in order to reduce a goiter, you need to begin thinking about addressing the cause, right? You now know that the cause of a goiter in almost all cases is related to an underlying autoimmune disease. And with that being said, I suggest you go to my website, learn more about what we call the triggers or causes of autoimmune Hashimoto's disease. You can Google Dr. Hagmeyer triggers of autoimmune disease, and I go through 7 or 8 or 9 or 10 of the most common triggers that we often test for and look for when we work with a patient where we have a known diagnosis of an autoimmune disease. Okay, so there you have it. If you like today's video, be sure to subscribe to it, comment below, share it with the people that you love and you care about, and again, tell us what you liked about today's video in the section below. All right, till next time, take care.